This is Solange. It is still dark when Solange leaves home at 5 a.m. for her job in the mines of Eastern Congo. Solange was only 17 when she became a widow and a mother of two little boys. I turned 18 just a few months ago, and this horrifies me. Solange started working in this mine when she was only 11. Children like her are working so we can make calls on our cell phones. Children like her are working so I could do research for this speech on my computer. Children like her are mining a component called coltan, a component that is essential for the production of many electronic devices. The DRC is one of the world's largest suppliers of this rare component. The extraction of coltan has been linked to environmental destruction, as these mines have destroyed many natural habitats. At the same time, it has also been linked to human rights abuses, child slavery, and corruption. Coltan mines are a prime example of how our environment is being overexploited due to production, and the world market for coltan is still rapidly growing. Our use of electronic devices is a microcosm of how our economy works. Think about how many electronic devices you own in your home. We live in a linear economy, which follows the take, make, dispose model. Unfortunately, value is created in this economic system by producing and selling as many products as possible. As we can see here, first, raw materials are extracted, sometimes by people like Solange, and then they're transformed into products like computers or phones. And then after they stop working, we discard them, which sometimes end up in landfills. Too often, we talk about the climate emergency through the lens of environmental science, but we also have to address the climate crisis through the lens of social inequity. Marginalized communities suffer most from pollution's impact. Existing issues like poverty, economic stagnation, and disease make the impacts of the climate emergency significantly more severe for the nations that contribute least to it. This disparity is not only seen between nations, but also in different neighborhoods in different cities. This is campaigner Cynthia Moore. She and her son recently moved to a neighborhood with a large Latinx population in East Las Vegas. It is near major roadways and construction seems to be constant. Since she and her son moved there from a wealthier suburb from Nevada, both she and her son have suffered respiratory issues. Whenever her son goes outside, he breaks out into rashes and has trouble breathing. In 2018, the US Environmental Protection Agency conducted a study that found that pollution is disproportionately located in communities of color. This refers to environmental racism. This refers to environmental racism, which means that there are biased policies and practices that result in toxic waste ending up in, and being more concentrated in lower income communities. These are the direct impacts on human health by pollution. Let's take another example, plastic. Plastic is the end product of this linear production model. In late 2018, I went on a trip to the Philippines, and some of my schoolmates and I worked on a construction site where a high school was to be built. When I was taking a break, I saw smoke in the distance. I was later told that it might be burning plastic, either to create energy or to get rid of the overwhelming amount of trash. Later that year, I watched a documentary called The Plastic Ocean. It took us to the endless landfills in Manila and in Tuvalu, where some areas are now drowning in plastic. These are the plastic that came from other countries. These landfills became playgrounds for children. Recognizing the intersection between climate issues and impacted communities, some companies like the Plastic Bank and the Alliance to End Plastic Waste are partnering with communities, experts, and companies. A project based in Accra, Ghana, uses a model that gathers plastic pickers in communities who sell the plastic waste to a local center where the plastics are regrinded and then sold to be reused in products like household materials. Not only is the waste management issue slightly alleviated in the city, the unlocked value of plastic is channeled back into these communities where jobs and new income streams are created. Negative impacts of the linear economy are mitigated, and it keeps waste products in use for as long as possible, and this creates a more linear economy. The climate movement is not only about protecting the planet, it is about caring for the people who live on the planet. If we continue to source raw materials and throw away the trash the way we do now, human rights issues and poverty may never be eradicated. We need to reframe the way we think and talk about the climate crisis, and we need to acknowledge that environmental issues do not exist in a vacuum. We need to recognize that people of color and lower income communities have borne disproportionate harm from pollution, and discriminatory systems have perpetuated these inequities. We can start by framing our discussions in ways that give voices to the social issues that arise from the climate crisis, starting in homes, at work, and at school. As investors, teachers, students, policymakers, and a citizen of the earth, how are you going to bring this discussion into your life? Less privileged communities are looking for solutions in their own countries, as they are the most impacted by waste in the climate emergency. What solutions can we find in our own lives to join a more circular economy? How can we do our best to keep our children like Solange out of the coltan mines in Congo and find better education and work opportunities for her and for the people in her community? Thank you.